Shalom. Shalom and greetings to all. Give thanks to those that accompany us this day. This is Ras Alonso Tafari reporting for the Lion of Judah Society of His Imperial Majesty Haile Selassie I and His Christ, His Christos, Jesus, that's to say HaMashiach Yeshua. So we begin by mentioning that today is Thursday, January 11th, 2018. It is 7:12 a.m. So, alright, this presentation will be concerning polygamy. Now, the reason this came up is because not too long ago, a sister of ours forwarded us a link in the which the link was to a video on YouTube done by a sister and addressing the Black Hebrew Israelite community and in regards to polygamy. So and my sister is basically her comment was like because of her position in standing firm against polygamy and refusing to, you know, to give in to an acceptance of polygamy, she forwarded the link to the video with a comment somewhere along the lines as to like this is a good video to, you know, to defend the case against polygamy. So and I checked out the video and you know, like what we're about to say has nothing to do with the individual, the woman presenting the information and stuff like that. It's just like basically what we thought of the video is like this is a horrible defense for a case against polygamy and yeah, basically. So we knew that there was far more that could have been said, although we had never really contemplated the, even, you know, the theme polygamy. And never even in our studies, it never even like crossed our mind. It's never been something that we even have shown the least bit of interest towards. But we knew that what the individual was saying was not necessarily the case. And so you know, immediately, just, you know, an abundance of information just kind of like rained on us within a few seconds, to be sincere. So now I guess there is a problem, and the video was addressing the Black Hebrew Israelite communities, and I and I as Rastafari do make mention that we know and have met many Rastas with this attitude, if not, you know, because a lot of women refuse to accept that, then it turns into individuals cheating continually in abundance, you know, and feeling justified somehow. Now, our opinion in regards to the video has nothing to do with the woman that presented, you know, her case. It has to do with looking at things like from a lawyer's perspective. If I was to defend my I don't even know what you call it, like my customers or clients, you know, case, if I'm to defend it, you know, I would have to bring forth a way stronger argument than what was presented in that video. So nothing against the sister, is just that on that basis of defending the case, her argument was not sufficient because she pretty much continuously stated that we cannot deny biblically that the practice of polygamy has always been a part of Hebrew Israelite tradition, custom, history. I forget the exact terms. She would continue saying that that, you know, we can't deny that it's a part of our life, basically, way of life. And along with it, her argument was basically the majority of pointing out the negativity that in most cases, you know, is a result of polygamous activity. And so and I knew that there's got to be something stronger than that. And so we took it on ourselves to, you know, just kind of bring forth this information that is the way that we were able to understand the things when we thought of what we are expressing. So now, let's see. This isn't necessarily addressing the Black Hebrew Israelite community, but I and my brethren and sistren can make use of the information that we provide here today. I and I is Rastafari, so we would address first and foremost to the Rastas that they prove themselves to be Rastafari, you know. And the simple answer to all this is no, polygamy is not acceptable. And now we're going to define polygamy like not only having more than one wife, but, you know, like the context of having more than one wife, or the reason, you know. It's not so basically, yes, there are circumstances in the Bible in which cases that would appear to be polygamy are taking place, but we'll go into details as to the proper context and how there's a specific commandment that is being attempted to be fulfilled, and then there's various different details that make a huge difference as to what nowadays people refer to as polygamy. I mean, just hooking up with different women at the same time because they feel like it, because they lust, because they like, because they're attracted, because, you know, they've known each other, because they can, supposedly. That's nothing that has ever been in the Hebrew Israelite way of life. Never. And never in Rastafari. Although, you know, I'm sure it has happened, continues happening, Jah willing. It becomes less in time to the point of extinction of it happening. But, you know, reality is that, you know, there is imperfection in man, and we commit sins and make mistakes. So, you know, Jah's revelation should not be misinterpreted on behalf of human error, which will always be present even amongst a perfect God, because we are imperfect, and, you know, we refuse to you know, maneuver as he would desire that we would. And so, you know, thus human error in all divine activity, you know. And that's a teaching in itself. Now continuing, let's see, the plain answer for Ina as Rastafari, if we are true and faithful, is that no, it's not acceptable, because we don't only have the you know, biblical scriptures, but we have the living testimony of the living Bible, you know, a translation from word to man. That is, you know, Haile Selassie first power of the Trinity, in whose heart Christ is, in whom Christ has allowed or made a room, a space, so that we may be with him in whom he is. So he goes to the Father, in the Father we are one, you know. So we have his living experience, his living testimony as the living translation of God's word, you know. So manifested through the vessel that is that chosen man, Haile Selassie first. And not only did he, during his coronation, not only did he go as far as to, like, going against, you know, coronation traditions and making it so that his woman can be sat upon the throne and crowned along, you know, among him, or along his side, in the same day, which was a practice not customary to ancient Ethiopian Christian, you know, like, coronation ceremony procedures. And so His Majesty went as far as to make it so that both man and woman be crowned on the same day. Why? Because since the beginning, you know, being two form one unit, you know, So now, aside from that, after the passing of Empress Menen, His Majesty, although biblically and legally able to, refused his right to, to wed again, or to, to marry another woman. He left it as is, showing us that even though it would have been biblically acceptable to take another wife, being that Empress Menen had passed, he still refused his liberty to do so. Perhaps maybe as a clear pointer that not even after life, after she lived, Empress Menen, not even after her life did His Majesty, give any indication that it is permissible to be with other than one woman. So now that's the plain and very simple answer to all this, and as Rastafari, that should suffice. But we're not only addressing, the Rastafari common unity, we're addressing all those that have ears to hear. Let them hear. Now, if Ina is wrong going into the details biblically, then Ina is wrong. Jah is still always right. Nonetheless, we do present our case and we feel very strongly about it. I'm sure many would agree. So, let's begin in the beginning. Genesis, first chapter. We're gonna try to avoid going to biblical references and try to just kind of like summarize all this, but I guess a couple verses are necessary to read out loud. So it says, "And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them." The unit was, is, and will ever be male and female, one flesh. Now, actually, I'm gonna read this next verse. I didn't have that in mind, but this is gonna be part of the key reason why, on a superficial, observation or observing things from a superficial level, or from just a, the physical, I guess, not deep into the soul of the word, it could appear that polygamy was, a practice within the way of life of Hebrew Israelites. But just listen to verse 28, first chapter Genesis. "And God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it." So now, just keep that in mind. So now, Ina was perhaps attempting to say something with that made one flesh. Well, maybe it'll come to us. Okay, I guess we'll just kind of like continue. So now, chapter 2, Genesis, verse 24. The same reads, "Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and they shall be one flesh." It doesn't, Jah took a rib from Adam and made a woman. Now, it's interesting because Adam misinterprets the situation, calls her woman, and finds out that I guess, in a way, he doesn't have possession over a woman like he did over the animals, calling them by their name. Later on, he realizes that, oh, Eve is her name, not woman as he first indicated or thought it to be. So that even shows that, the situation amongst Adam and who he interpreted as woman at first is not the case, and learns that she is Eve. Now, there's something in that in itself, something to meditate. But continuing, Jah took a rib from Adam and made a partner for him, a helpmate. Now, he didn't make two helpmates. He didn't, you know, Adam didn't realize that Eve, Crystal, Christine, Jennifer, Susan, and no, just Eve, you know, God did not make, you know, all these women for Adam. He made one. So it's very simple from the beginning. That's the intent. And oh yeah, okay, and I just remembered what we kind of had forgotten a minute ago. We must be careful when interpreting scripture, because the way it works is basically that you know, our what we get out of scripture is actually what we have within. So whatever we express as our understanding, comprehension, and interpretation of the scripture is actually a reflection, is actually like illumine, or it's bringing to light that which we bear within, that which is in our hearts and mind. And so whatever we see is what we really are. So we must be careful with our interpretations in regards to scripture. So if we feel that we can express death from a scripture, then we must automatically, you know, stop and find a way to interpret life out of that same scripture, because we're not taught death. Even if the Bible says the word death, we must find and figure out the way to shed light to life using a same scripture that could, on a superficial, you know, level, be interpreted as amounting to death, which is not the case. If Yeshua HaMashiach is the word made flesh, he did not teach us condemnation, you know, or he did not teach us, you know, like, death from the scriptures. He taught life, and thus, even though the Old Testament ones would say is full of death, we must rearrange it so that it is full of pure life, so that what we reflect, how we judge things, be in our favor, so that we be judged the same way. Thus, if we see the acceptance of polygamy in a scripture, that reflects our inner desire. Now, scripture is powerful enough to sustain a claim that is invalid when the desire is present. There'll be evidence to support any man's case. The thing is that, you know, I warn ones to reflect on the case that we build. And if it's just kind of off, because for obvious reasons, even because something inside of us tells us that it's off, you know, we must kind of like, you know, not rush to make those judgments, because then we condemn ourselves in that we shall be judged in like manner. And because I personally am a sinner, then every time that I see something that someone in scripture that sin could be attributed to him, then I must find the way to disprove that and to prove how he is guiltless of, even after committing such sin. So, you know, if I work as a lawyer in the defense of biblical characters, then the way that I have judged, Jah shall judge upon me, you know, and behold a mercy seat upon the which I am to be seated. You know, that's what the scripture indicates, and Yeshua declared it, His Majesty confirmed it. I mean, so that's just the way that we've learned to accept, you know, the oral tradition, which is not passed down from man, but is the voice from heaven which speaks within, the which passes on, you know, the things otherwise not in scripture that are in scripture. So now, continuing, we'll talk about Yeshua's point of view and all that towards the end. Now, we're going to try to, you know, speed this up a little bit. Basically, what's going on? Let's begin with Abram. And Sarai. We have to make note that one thing, that they left the land, And then once they reach the promised land, there's famine. Famine is always a trial, a test, a temptation even. But you cannot satisfy a spiritual necessity with material goods or physical nutrition. But Abraham and Sarai make the mistake of descending down into the material world, having been in the promised land, thus not really needing anything, because famine would just be equivalent to desire. Having obtained the promise, we leave it for the acquisition of physical and material goods that appear to be blessings and riches, but then become burden upon our own back that we ourselves, acquired of our own, disobedience. So Abraham and Sarai, they descend down into Egypt. So they failed the test. And what happens, basically, Abraham asks Sarai, we'll say that you're my sister because you're, you're fair, good look at, you're beautiful, and they'll surely kill me for, to take you. And so what happens, Pharaoh ends up taking Sarai, and in exchange, Abraham gets all kinds of riches, including maid servants and or handmaids and like slaves basically, and cattle, all kinds of so-called riches that later prove themselves to be a burden upon Sarai and Abraham. Now, but Pharaoh figures out that, okay, that's your wife. Why would you have lied to me? You put me in jeopardy. Don't you know that a woman is to be to his husband? I mean, even Pharaoh is kind of like, very conscious of the fact that, oh, that's this man's wife. I cannot F with that. I mean, that goes to show how universally accepted this truth has been at points in times in history. So now, basically, throughout the scripture, Abraham gets promised, you'll be a father of many nations. You'll, your seed shall be in abundance. Basically, he's promised the ability to be fruitful and multiply. But now, returning to the promised land, they return with less faith and with riches. And particularly, we'd like to focus on Hagar, a maidservant, which was an acquisition in Abraham and Sarai's trip to Egypt. That's to say that Sarai came back to the, or came forward to the promised land after leaving Egypt with a with slaves basically, and less faith. So now they're contemplating within themselves, and well, I'm old, I don't have children, God promised, so what's really going on? Maybe because I don't have faith in God as I perhaps once did, maybe I have to interfere. And now that I got this new handmaid, this new slave Hagar, maybe God meant that through her I am to have, seed with my husband, and thus fulfilled, be fruitful and multiply, which is, the blessing the which has been promised Abraham. But he has no that's to say he's not Abraham, he has no people, So basically, the woman initiates this error, and Sarai goes to Abraham, says, why don't you go into Hagar, my slave, maidservant, that I may bear children through my property, through her, through my slave. And as soon as that happens, Sarai realizes that she made a mistake, and Ishmael is born, so a big problem, so nothing good came from that. Now, there's the details that that are very different to what people wanna claim to be, polygamy then, so-called. There's a lot of, particularities that make the situation different as to what people wanna do today, and use the old context, which is biblical. In this case, we're talking about Abraham and Sarai, and use that as evidence to sustain a whole different story, which is not valid, that argument is not valid. First of all, the woman initiated this action, and she initiated this action and gave to him, to wife, to bride, her slave, which is her property, which is very different. That's a part of her, that's an extension of the body of Sarai, because that's her property, you know? But the key thing to take note of is that it was because of being barren, because of not being able to produce, you know, to give life to a youth, the inability to become pregnant and have children, the barrenness of Sarai was her motivation to ask her husband to take to wife Hagar, and through her property, Sarai's property, then Sarai thought that she could, you know, fulfill her duty as a Hebrew Israelite to woman and be fruitful and multiply. This is a whole different context as to what people want to say, you know, like defend nowadays. So this is this is strictly out of necessity, and this is involving circumstances and scenario situations that are way different than today. Does a man want to take the slave of his wife that the wife initiated in asking the man to lay with her because of her inability to bear fruit? I mean, if that's the case, then, you know, you're at fault because you got slaves, and that's illegal, first and foremost. So it won't work out regardless. Now, having said all this, you know, the only ones that actually do the right thing is Yitzhak and Rivka, and I think, let's see, a reference would be, let's see, Genesis 25, verse 21, I believe it is, and basically says, and Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord was entreated of him. I believe that's what it said, was entreated of him, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived. So basically all that had to be done in the part of, you know, Abram and Sarai was like for Abram to, you know, go to Jai and, hey, what's up? And eventually, you know, it did happen and stuff like that. You know, God told them, no, it's not Ishmael. You're going to have, you know, seed with Sarai. And stuff like that. So, but yeah, they learned their lesson. Nonetheless, this was the way to go. And now we continue on to Yaakov, another circumstance in which, Abraham took Keturah, you know, after the life of Sarah. So, you know, keep that in mind. That wasn't, you know, marriage of different women at the same time. And now, Yaakov. Basically, what happens here is also a very particular case. It's not like the norm. Basically, Yaakov falls in love with a woman, Rachel, and then he works for her, and he's tricked because the traditions of man, you know, and so they give to him Leah, the eldest, and lays with her, realizes that this has been done. He complains, why hast thou done such? For I paid my wages for Rachel, and, you know, behold, it is Leah. Like, what the F is going on? Now, any future, like, error could have been avoided if Yaakov could have just accepted that, okay, he was tricked, it's not his fault, get over the lust, forget about Rachel, you have a woman, you have a wife, just accept that, you know, although it wasn't fair or anything like that, but, you know, life doesn't always appear to be fair. But no, his lust after Rachel caused him to overlook the reality of the situation, that he has a wife and must not take another, and basically he overrides that within himself, justifying it with the fact that he was tricked. And of course, this is all speculation, but it could it could very well be, you know, interpreted in such a way. So, so he works some more years and takes Rachel to bride. Now, Leah also has slaves, and Rachel also has slaves. Now, because Leah was hated and Rachel was loved, Jah comes to the assistance of those that are downpressed and open the womb of Leah. Now, Rachel noticed that she could not bear children. So once again, because of her inability to be fruitful and multiply, he, the woman, initiates the transaction of, hey, you husband, why don't you go into my property, my slave? And through her, I shall conceive because she's my property, an extension of my body, and whatever is of, she's not even of herself. So nothing that comes from her is of herself. So it's actually mine. And so I will have children, give children to you, my husband, through my slave. Once again, the same scenario. The woman initiated it, and out of the necessity of fulfilling the commandment to multiply, be fruitful and multiply. You know, the desperateness to be able to bear children, as at least, if only even through one's slave. Now, after that happened, Leah stopped bearing children, and she goes through the same situation. She's all like, okay, I can't bear children no more. I haven't, you know, born children. So I'll do this. Husband, go into my, you know, go into my handmaid, my slave, same situation. And, once that happens, I think Rachel gives birth to children, and then eventually God opens up the womb of Leah once more. And another important verse would be, I guess, I think it's Genesis 30, somewhere around, like, verse, I don't know, I think it's 20, perhaps. And Leah said, God hath endued me with a good dowry. Now my husband will dwell with me because I have borne him 6 sons. Basically, all that I want to, you know, get out of this is that this madness was out of despair to you know, a competition to be fruitful and multiply and to gain the love of the man that did not desire her. You know, honestly, Jacob should have just forgotten about Rachel, accepted what had been done to him, whether unfair, whatever, and avoided having made one less and felt bad, you know, because he favored another, which he should not have taken, even though, you know, the whole situation is drama, you know. So now Leah's like, now he's really going to be with me. Now we're going to be one. Now he's really going to love me because I have borne him 6 children, you know. So it's all out of, you know, this desire to fulfill a woman's ability. Perhaps they see it as a responsibility to give light to life, you know. Otherwise, what's, you know, what purpose would a womb serve? And so these are way different circumstances than what people want to justify the biblical accounts with their whatever nonsense they're going through. Now, all that being said, you know, I think, let's see, in Samuel, I believe there's another instance where there's 2 wives, but once again, the mother of Samuel, I believe, is barren. So even though I don't know the details, there's probably some same pattern taking place. And so eventually she conceives a Nazarite and all that. So now, having said all that, as Rastafari, and this is, I guess, no pun intended, but at the same time, you know, it is what it is. You know, the Rastas, we like to say, oh, King Man, and I Queen. All right, well, if ones are truly a king, then man up to this very, very obvious, very simple instruction to kings, to those that call themselves or kind of like to be addressed as King Man or whatever. So basically, Deuteronomy chapter 17, the requirements that must be fulfilled for a king to be established in Israel, which are very simple, actually. We're not going to go through them all, but basically the one we got to focus on is verse 17, the which reads, "Neither shall he multiply wives to himself." Very, you know, you can't be a king man in Israel if you multiply wives, because, you know, that's what lost Solomon the authority. That's what caused Jah to divorce Jerusalem and take Ethiopia as a bride. You know, the multiplication of wives that led to the, you know, the worship of foreign gods, which is not proper. And, you know, Solomon had many wives, and thus, you know, Menelik first, behold, a greater than Solomon. Now, do not multiply wives to himself, that his heart turn not away, neither shall he greatly multiply to himself silver or gold. Goes off, basically, and it shall be when he sitteth upon the throne of his kingdom that he shall write him a copy of this law in a book out of that which is before the priests and the Levites. In other words, you shall memorize, practice, rehearse, read, study, the handwrite, if you have to, a Bible, the law of the book, you know, before the Levites, before, you know, the spiritual mediators, so that you will not ever forget that which you are called to be and assume to be more than you're not, basically. So that one can be kept humble in Jah's word all the days of one life. So if we don't study, we don't know these things. Nonetheless, you know, ones want to be called kingman, then you can't multiply wives. It's very simple. His Majesty, the King of Kings, did not so. Even Christ went as far as to not take a bride in the flesh, for the Father would call him, as the Hebrew tradition would require for it to be thus. That is to say, when the Father, Haile Selassie I, calls the Son and presents him with a bride, then the Son even, you know, like, comes forward and takes his woman, but having refused his human liberty to, you know, to conceive and to marry, he does it in the Hebrew Israelite way. That is to say, the Father, when he sees that his son is ready, then, you know, the Father makes the move. And thus is the situation with Christ taking one woman that the Father hath prepared for him. So, having said all that, let's see. Even Jah, you know, we can't have other gods, you know what I'm saying? So, it's, you know, this reality is embedded in the scriptures. No, polygamy is not a practice of Hebrew Israelites. Shit happened, and stuff went down a certain way, but it's not because it's a tradition or it's the law or anything. You know, context. I don't know, it's kind of very obvious for I and I to kind of like cite that, but others may think otherwise. So let's just kind of like wrap this up with an account of Matthew, let's see, 19:3. And I know I'm not trying to kind of go through all this, but basically, Pharisees ask him, is it okay for a man to leave a wife for any reason? Now, question, why should a man leave a woman for any reason? To hook up with another woman? If that's the case, why don't you just hook up with another woman? Because the Hebrew Israelites practiced polygamy ever since the beginning. No, because everybody, even the Pharisees, know that everyone is in agreement. Like, all the, you know, when Yeshua talks about this marriage and all that, everyone's, like, not even arguing or bringing up the case of many wives, it's the context is always about one wife at a time, and how often can you do it, and for what reasons. So basically, Yeshua goes to the beginning, you know, in the beginning made God male and female, one flesh, you know. So it's very simple, it's not that complicated. What God hath joined, let no man put asunder. So they say to him, but Moses, you know, write a bill of divorcement. And then basically Yeshua goes into like, listen, you guys were doing it anyways. Moses just kind of put restrictions and made it kind of so that you guys wouldn't, you know, continue just taking advantage and stuff like that. But it was because of the hardness of your heart. But God did not intend it to be such since the beginning. But notice, the context here is talking about giving one woman a bill of divorcement. It's not talking about many wives, or that's not even brought up. You know, and if it's such a tradition, you know, then how come it's not even referred to? It's like everyone is pretty clear on the fact that, okay, one wife at a time. So now, you know, even the disciples, basically, oh, after Yeshua says, only if a woman commits adultery, you know, is it really spiritually and physically, you know, in its fullness, okay for you to, for divorce, or for fornication, it says, except it be for fornication, which is, okay, anyways, it says here, his disciples say to him, if the case of the man be so with his wife, it is not good to marry. In other words, it's like, damn, like, if that's the case, it's better not to get married. Just F around, you know? I mean, what's the point of getting married if you can't get rid of the... I mean, why would they say that? Why would they be against, even his disciples, why would they be against a woman, or against us only being able to leave a woman for fornication? That should be a good thing. But no, it's like, the attitude is more like, well, we want to get with other women, but we know we can only have one woman at a time. So you're telling me I can't leave the woman I'm with only for fornication? And then, you know, probably to add some comedy to this, so some, you know, some brethren might look at, you know, the woman and be like, that's never going to happen. That means I'm stuck with her. It's better. I should have not gotten married. You know, that's kind of like the attitude. And, which is kind of like, kind of embarrassing, because it just, you know, points out the reality of man's mind, where it's at, you know. I think in another scripture, they're like, once they on their own, they're like, nah, Yeshua, for reals? I mean, like that, you can only have, like, one wife? Like, you gotta be kidding me, right? Now, I'm not sure if that, I kind of have this vague memory of something like that. Nonetheless, you know, forgive if I'm not correct on that, but you know, not everybody could receive the same eunuchs. Then he goes, Yeshua goes off to talk about eunuchs and stuff like that, you know. And, basically, you know, if you can't keep your thing, you know, like, from messing around, you know, cut it off. So, yeah, I think, and I mean, there's other places in the New Testament we could go to, but it should, you know, for Rastafari, it should suffice to just see that His Majesty wasn't effing around with this one and that one. He had one wife, she passed after living, and then he didn't even take no other wife. So that's very obvious. I mean, what else do we need? You know, if we proclaim Him to be our Emperor, our King of Kings, then you know, then come on. I mean, then that means that He reigns over us. That means we can't just do whatever we feel like doing. I mean, He set the precedent. He set the example. He's the head. You know, so let us follow and give reverence to whom reverence is due. He is Jah, you know, Rastafari, the head to revere, to give reverence to, the example, the first. So with that, we conclude this presentation on polygamy. No, it is not acceptable. And it's never been a practice, you know, in Hebrew Israelite truth or way of life. It has happened, you know. Man makes mistakes. We do commit sins from time to time. But even as we do that, we know in our hearts, as Christians, that we have the possibility of forgiveness from the Almighty. You know. Actually, we'll conclude this presentation by actually reading the fullness of that, which I only kind of like said a little bit about. Let's see. Pardon I, one second. When Jesus Christos was born from Virgin Mary, from that time on, he lived an exemplary life, a life which men everywhere must emulate. This life and the faith which he has taught us assures us of salvation, assures us also of harmony and good life upon earth. Because of the exemplary character of the life of Jesus Christos, it is necessary that all men do their maximum in their human efforts to see to it that they approximate as much as they can the good example that has been set by him. It's quite true that there's no perfection in humanity. From time to time we make mistakes, we do commit sins, but even as we do that, deep in our hearts as Christians, we know we have a chance of forgiveness from the Almighty. He taught us that all men are equal regardless of sex, their national origin, and tribe, and he also taught us all who seek him shall find him. To live in this healthy life, a Christian life, is what makes me follow Jesus Christos. Haile Selassie first. Germanic Edamar Selassie.